What's up, everybody? Welcome into the Next Pats Podcast. I'm Phil Perry. It is a Drake May week here at NBC Sports Boston. We have all sorts of content on NBCSportsBoston.com, on the Patriots Talk Podcast. Hopefully, you've been watching early edition Boston Sports Tonight. We are hammering you with all things May Watch, okay? We're going to go a little bit deeper here on the Next Pats Podcast today. I know that's what you anticipate from us every time we drop a Next Pats Podcast, but I wanted to make sure we dug deep on the X's and O's of what we should expect from Drake May as early as this weekend against the Houston Texans. What does the scheme look like? What does Alex Van Pelt have dialed up to make his young quarterback look as good as he can look against what is a ferocious Houston Texans front? So we're bringing in our buddy, Taylor Kyles from CLNS Media, does a fantastic job of breaking down plays and concepts and understanding what works and what doesn't, especially for somebody like Drake May, who we've all been watching so closely since before the draft, during his time at North Carolina, then obviously during the spring, OTAs, training camp, preseason, one game or one drive, 16 plays against the New York Jets earlier this year. And now we're trying to project moving forward what this thing will look like. It's a great conversation with Taylor. We're going to get to it right now. There he is. There's our friend, Taylor Kyles from CLNS Media, Patriots reporter, Patriots analyst, does it all, quite frankly. And here today, we're going to ask him to help us break down what we think the Drake May offense will look like on Sunday against the Houston Texans. Taylor, thanks so much for being with us, buddy. I'm excited to get to pick your brain a little bit here.
Thanks for having me, pal. You know, I always love talking X's and O's with you. Let's get into it. It's going to be fun.
So what should this look like, in your opinion? Let's start there, because we know what the Alex Van Pelt offense is, right? After watching training camp, after watching five games with Jacoby Brissett, who we know Alex Van Pelt really has a lot of affinity for, and his ability to play on time and in rhythm and have the proper footwork. Obviously, those things didn't yield much in terms of offensive production. So what can they do differently? What should this look like, in your opinion?
Well, it's got to start with the run game, to be honest. And I know that's not sexy, but we're talking about a 22-year-old in his first career start. I think if Drake May is dropping back 30 times, like we've seen from Jacoby Brissett, every game except the one game that they actually won, you're setting him up for failure. Now, that said, I think there's plenty of ways they can make sure that he still gets the big plays and you get the efficiency, maybe minimize some of the risk with, you know, the offensive line, some continuity there, but still Nick Leverett on the injury report. We don't know what's going to go on at center, but empty is one thing that I really liked last week in the offense. We saw DeMario Douglas caught three passes for 50 yards on routes over the middle of the field from empty. He had some quick hitters to tight ends. The almost game-winning touchdown to Jalen Polk was on a great empty concept where they made it look like one thing and then put a defender in conflict, and obviously very close to getting them that win against Miami. So Drake May was really good out of empty, especially when he was pushing the ball downfield. And with an athletic quarterback, you got to be careful with how you rush him, because if you leave a gap that's too open, whether it's on the edge or up the middle, Drake May can take advantage. So I love that. And then I'm shaky on under center stuff, because we saw he and Nick Leverett had some under center exchange issues during the preseason. So maybe a little bit more gun, you know, some pistol, something where he can still turn his back to the defense, but have that illusion of the run. Also keep him deeper in the pocket for a little more protection. And then you want to get those shot plays downfield, whether it's eight man protection, you know, whatever you got to do, keep him clean and let him fire deep down the field, because that's what he's best at.
So a lot of interesting stuff there. And I'm with you when it comes to empty. To me, that makes a lot of sense, especially for a young quarterback. And you might say, well, you're only going with five-man protection against this Houston Texans defense with a bad offensive line and a rookie quarterback. And I get it. Those are all valid questions and valid concerns if you're a Patriots fan out there experiencing those things right now. But empty also should allow him to get the ball out of his hands quickly and maybe make the defense a little bit easier for a guy who's in his first start as a professional to decipher what's going on across the line of scrimmage, right? Do you feel as though that's something, given what we saw from him in preseason and in training camp, that he'll be able to do?
I do. So there's a difference between like quick throws and then those rhythm throws, where in empty especially, I think the rhythm throws will work well, where it's a three-step drop, sometimes a five-step, or something where he hits his back foot, maybe one hitch, get the ball out. That's something with Jacoby. Sometimes there'd be too many hitches, and that made what was already shaky pass protection look even worse. Now, quick game's a little shakier, because Drake May's been inconsistent since the preseason. A lot of that is because it is very mechanical. Drake May is a natural athlete. If you watch him, the way he reads defenses, the way he plays the game, it's got a natural feel to it, although he is still very raw. But when you say, okay, you're literally just three-step, no-hitch, get the ball out of your hand, you've seen that sometimes he opens too wide, or the process, he's still kind of getting it under his shoes. That's actually where Jacoby Brissett kind of thrived, and one of the reasons I think they felt more comfortable with him, where, hey, if we got to get the ball out quick, Jacoby's going to give guys the best opportunity for yak. But at the same time, on those three-step, you know, get it out, pushing the ball downfield again, that's where I think he'll be at his best, and also just getting the ball to his checkdowns as well. He has a good sense for when to do that.
Yeah, you're right. When it comes to the quick game stuff, we saw a fair amount of that when he was inserted to that Jets game late. And it was obviously they were way behind. The game was out of hand, but it was essentially 2 minute. And it sounds like that was what they were calling, was a lot of quick game. And his first drop back, most people listening to this podcast would probably remember, probably should have been intercepted. It might have ended his first professional drive after just one play. So maybe just a sprinkling of that sort of stuff.
He didn't get the open guy, then just tried to run up the middle, and then he took a big hit and got himself buried. So, like, to your point.
And those are mistakes that are going to happen, right? I think we all have to acknowledge he's going to get hit. He's in all likelihood going to get sacked, not just because of what's in front of him, but because he's a young quarterback who's still trying to figure out what it is. He's looking at. How about you mentioned the under center versus shotgun split, if you will. If they don't do a lot of under center, because it is still relatively new to him, you're right on the quarterback center exchange. That was an adventure every single day this past summer, whether it was Nick Levert or anybody else, Antonio Maffi back there playing center. If they don't want to go under center, does that then limit what they can do in terms of the play action game? Because we know what Alex Van Pelt's bread and butter is. They are among the league leaders in terms of under snap offensive plays to this point in the season. If they get away from that, does it force Alex Van Pelt to get away from some of the play action stuff that he likes?
I do wonder, because I think when it comes to the footwork, maybe you just reduce how deep he's going into his drop. It's like when you're in shotgun versus under center. A five-step drop in shotgun isn't really a five-step drop. It's more like a seven-step, because you have to include the steps it would be if you were under center. So I think with pistol, you may be able to adjust it, run the same concepts, and have the footwork still kind of match up with the routes, which you know is so important in the West Coast offense and in, like I said, these rhythm throws. But if Van Pelt does want to go more under center, yeah, it might. If there's certain concepts where he doesn't feel like being at that certain depth matches with what he wants to run, you know, that's honestly, I wish we'd asked him today, but that is a really good question.
How much pistol have we seen much pistol from them? Because you would know better than me. You tracked this stuff so well for CLNS, and I just can't remember. I'm trying to think in my mind's eye, okay, did we see it in preseason? Did we see it in training camp? And I can't recall a ton of it. So is that something they would have to install almost, in your opinion, like this week, in order for it to be part of the game plan for Sunday?
Kind of. I think straight pistol we've seen maybe once, and then DeMario Douglas has those orbit motion packages. He's caught a pitch on that, but that's really been the extent of it. So it would definitely be new, but we also know Alex Van Pelt. What has he been preaching to us? You have to tailor the offense to the guys that you have on the field. And if that means, hey, we have to find a way for Drake to be as comfortable as we can, especially if, you know, under center exchanges are a problem in practice, then you're going to have to say, all right, this is necessary. So I think if Van Pelt is the offensive coordinator that we are hoping he is and that he's been saying he is, he'll find some way to make sure that Drake isn't in those more disadvantageous situations.
So to me, there are almost three ways you can tweak the offense to benefit your new quarterback here. One of them is just to emphasize the things you've already been doing, but emphasize them differently to better adhere to the skill set of the guy who's actually going to be out there. So whether it's, you know, we've already seen empty, for instance, with Jacoby Brissett. Do you do more of that? Do you use more shotgun types of calls because you feel like Drake May would just be plain and simple as a guy who took almost all of his offensive snaps from the shotgun in college? He'd just be more comfortable in those types of scenarios. So that's one way. The other way to me would be, do you start to incorporate some new things that you wouldn't have done plain and simple for Jacoby Brissett, like, for instance, Taylor, some RPO stuff, some zone read stuff. We saw Drake May run for a touchdown on a zone read play in the preseason. How much of that do you think will be incorporated this week? Because I would assume they're going to want to try to leverage his athleticism and allow him to use his legs to benefit the offense.
100%. Van Pelt and May will both acknowledge that he can do stuff with his legs, and he'll probably be involved in the QB run game. I don't know if he's not going to be Jaden Daniels necessarily, but I think especially in short yardage in the red zone, we saw in college, he's plenty capable in those situations. He can definitely do that. Some of the RPO things, I do wonder whether Van Pelt's just more comfortable with screens and not downfield concepts. But Drake May did execute those in college. Now, they're more lenient in college. You have a little, like a tick more time in college to throw those downfield RPOs. So we're going to have to see how comfortable he is with that. But also moving pockets, like the bootlegs, where we've seen Jacoby Brissett miss a couple of really big downfield opportunities because he couldn't connect on the run. Now, Drake isn't perfect in those situations either, but at least he can use his legs. And there's a little bit more fear where when he has depth in the pocket, you can't just run at him, because if you miss, he can just take off and run on his own. Or even, you know, sprint outs where you're just moving the pocket to get a first down on, you know, third and five, you get a pick play and you get an easy kind of conversion. Whereas with Brissett, you weren't as comfortable with him on the run. And honestly, I was actually just reminded of something that Jacoby Brissett reminded of us today. They both are making their debut against the Texans at home. And then if you look even deeper, Josh McDaniels had to create basically a brand new type of offense that matched Jacoby, where, you know what, we're going to run. We're going to get him involved in the run game. That kind of was one of the really poster moments for Josh McDaniels being able to adjust so quickly. Maybe we see that this week from AVP.
Here's the benefit, right? When you compare and contrast those situations, the benefit that these current 2024 Patriots have over those 2016 Patriots is that Drake May and the Drake May stuff, my understanding is already been incorporated. They've been working on it, right? He's been getting first team reps. They've been able to obviously see a lot of him in training camp, which Jacoby Brissett, when he was a rookie in 2016, really didn't play at all. And they were, you know, at least in competitive situations. And so they weren't running that sort of stuff on a regular basis in practice. Whereas now, I think everybody's a little bit more accustomed to that. I do wonder if, you know, we assume, and Alex Van Pelt talked about it a little bit today, you know, Drake May is going to use his legs as a natural playmaker. And I think the situations he was describing were when he's under pressure, when he's forced to use his legs, when he sees an opening and he wants to get creative. But the design stuff, the zone read stuff, the sprint out passes. Again, we've seen some sprint out passes from Jacoby Brissett this year. Not many. I don't think they benefit Brissett's skill set as much as they might for Drake May. So maybe we see more of those. The third element, though, that I wanted to ask you about here is, because I know you watched a lot of his North Carolina tape, as we all did.
Too much.
Is there anything you can dig back into in the recesses of your memory and say, boy, I would love it if they could install this concept for him this week, if they haven't already, because I saw him do this at North Carolina. He was so comfortable, and I think they could make it work. What would that be?
I'd like to see them create – well, Jalen Polk, I should start with, really has taken that ex-receiver role from Tyquan Thornton. We've also seen some of it from Kayshon Booty. Jalen Polk and Drake May, we've known that since the day they got on the field together, they've been spending extra time trying to get the back shoulder, more chemistry stuff under wraps. And really, that's a place where I think we tried to see Jacoby press and give Jalen Polk those one-on-one opportunities. I just don't think their skill sets really vibed. But what they did at UNC was Tez Walker. A lot of the success that he had and what Drake May had was exploiting those, you know, three by one where, hey, you're one-on-one. I know how you win. I know when to give you the back shoulder, when to lead you because you're going to stack. I'm just going to let you win. Those are the easy buttons for an offense where you can still push the ball downfield, but you don't really have to worry about hitching and buying time because you have a natural rhythm and you know how you can throw the ball while mitigating your offensive line. Really, that's the biggest thing for me is if Polk can also capitalize, but to give him some of those easy looks where it's three by one, almost every defense in the NFL is going to have you one-on-one because they want to push coverage to where most of the numbers are. Create those situations and see if those guys can take the chemistry that we think that they have on the practice field, translate it to the game field.
I know those guys have been working, whether it's Polk, Pop Douglas, I know is part of this group as well. Drake May working with some of the younger receivers, but guys that are playing obviously a lot and that are considered starters after practice. So not only is he getting the 30% of the, or has he been getting the 30% of the starting reps, not only has he been doing a lot of the scout team, but he's been working with these guys after the fact too, to try to get this chemistry down, try to get the rhythm down that we know is so important for that passer to pass catcher sort of development. And I think you're going to see groups or tandems, whether it's Douglas in May or whether it's Polk in May, that are more ready to go than people might assume for a rookie quarterback who's making his first start, because he has racked up all of these reps. You make a good point about the hitching. I do I do find it interesting if they can find ways, the way you're describing, to get him to strike down the field without climbing up in the pocket, because that scares me a little bit, Taylor, because we've seen with this offensive line, the middle's not always solidified. And so if you're trusting your feet, which that's written on the wall in the quarterback room, trust your feet, and the hitch is supposed to tell you where to go with the football in this system. If you're hitching up, sometimes you're bringing trouble into the equation. And I'd love for them to find a way for him to avoid that while also still taking advantage of his arm strength and his down the field accuracy, which we saw at times during training camp.
Yeah. And you saw that with Tom Brady, like obviously that's the poster child for good footwork. And how many times he's not really hitching unless he has to. If he feels pressure, he will, but he's okay just standing there and kind of navigating the pressure as it comes. Now, Drake May, I do think, has some natural pocket feel, but he's got some lapses where sometimes he'll see a soft edge because a defensive end went inside and he's thinking, oh, I'm just going to use this and give myself a better platform. But what happens is then you got a defensive tackle or a linebacker who's coming around and he's trying to whack you. Now, that happened against the Jets, and he made an off-platform throw where his footwork wasn't good. He wasn't really aligned, and he threw a great anticipation throw over the middle to DeMario Douglas. So the nice thing about Drake May, and that we're going to see, he doesn't really have to be perfect. And with, you know, Mac Jones, it had to be perfect every time we saw the results. And you're going to see that with Drake May as well. When the footwork isn't perfect, you know, some are going to fly on him and some are going to sail or what have you. But I absolutely agree that you want to make sure that pocket is strong. And I think that's why they wanted Mike and Winnie back inside. And then Michael Jordan, who has some chemistry with Vidarian Lowe. Now, obviously, center kind of throws a wrench into all that because communication is going to be dicier. And then just the quality of player, obviously, you step down from David Andrews, that's tough. But I think May gives them a better shot than Jacoby, where when those pockets started to collapse on him, he really didn't have a shot to get the ball half at times, even though he did occasionally. But Drake, it doesn't have to be perfect, but of course, you don't want to put him in situations that he could potentially develop some bad habits.
You know, it's really interesting when you're talking about the pressure that he might experience. Just having conversations with players in the locker room this week and understanding that May was going to be the choice moving forward, you're reminded that somebody with his physical skill set really forces defenses, I think in a few different ways, to become almost one-dimensional. And I mean, from a pass rush standpoint, if you're Danielle Hunter and you want to fly up the field and you want to run the hoop, you can. But against Drake May, he's going to be a threat in a way that Jacoby Brissett or another true pocket passer wouldn't be if you leave that B gap open and Vidarian Lowe just lets you run on by and he sees a ton of green in front of him. He can take off and pick up 8 or 10 yards. And then I think even in the secondary, just having a mobile quarterback, which Taylor, you and I haven't really been able to cover here in New England, you could certainly include Cam Newton in that conversation. He wasn't necessarily threatening people, especially deep down the field with his arm. So you don't get the benefit of, okay, we're in man coverage defensively. If I turn my back and I follow my assignment deep down the field, we might be screwed because if he breaks the pocket, he might just be running behind me and I would never know. You know, these are the kinds of things that we talk about for the Patriots defense having to worry about all the time. Well, now the Texans will have to concern themselves with the two in a way that they wouldn't have if Jacoby Brissett was still starting. And I wonder if that helps them at all in this game moving forward. The last thing I wanted to ask you about, Drake May's anticipation to me, Taylor, as a passer is something that I'm really keen on watching this week because it's hard to tell. How does he handle the speed of a regular season game? What are his nerves like? But to me, that's really what stood out on some of his best throws in the preseason was he's throwing to a spot. Do you think we'll be able to see some of that ability to attack the middle of the field that we saw so often at North Carolina as soon as this weekend?
That's his strength. It's funny because I've been trying to do diagrams of plays and get into that more. And when I did it for Jacoby, it was really just like straight lines I was doing to the target. With Drake, I'm like, oh, I should actually be pointing to where he's throwing because it's rarely at the receiver. And that's why he was so good at attacking the middle and why he was so productive and why I say that he seems like a natural because he doesn't have a ton of experience, but he understands where the defense's voids are. And if that means, you know what, you want to play corners. Everybody's playing corners, the Vic Fangio scheme, all the split safety stuff. That's great when you're playing a quarterback who can't throw that deep post and put it on the money. But what did we see against the Eagles? Javon Baker, they played a coverage where he was one-on-one and they played that kind of split safety thing, left the deep middle one-on-one. Drake May used his eyes to hold the coverage, let that thing go, dropped it in the basket. It would have been, I think, like a 60-yard completion or something like that. That's the kind of skill set that we haven't had in a really long time. And when, whether it's his legs or just what he can do in the pocket, being able to move defenders, we heard Joe Milton talk about it. Defensive coaches are talking about it. That's not really been there for Jacoby either, where he's putting his eyes here because he knows he's trying to move somebody. I'm studying quarterbacks every week, like Geno and all these guys that are doing it, Brock Purdy. And I asked Drake exactly that. What did you learn from emulating those guys on the scout team? And he mentioned, hey, you know, timing, rhythm, anticipation. I'm throwing routes I've never even thrown before in my life, but I have to trust my guy's going to be there to give the defense a good look. And we've heard nothing but good things about the effort he put in. So if you can't tell, I'm really excited because there's going to be bumps and things are going to be rough. But really, this is truly a kid that has everything you want, work ethic, talent, all that. And I think that he's going to put up some fireworks this weekend. There's going to be some rough patches, but we're going to have some fun, Phil. Press box vibe is going to be very different.
There's no question, right? He's going to hit bumps in the road, but you have to be able to live with that if you're any organization in the NFL that's starting a rookie quarterback for the first time. No, this should be a hopeful time. You're right, Taylor, for Patriots fans. Hopefully it's an exciting time for Patriots fans, even against a difficult opponent this week. They had to make the change, in my opinion. You have to do right by everyone in the organization and do everything you can to help the product on the field look a little bit better than it's looked. There's no perfect time, as Gerard Mayo mentioned before. This defense is going to be a little tougher than the one maybe they face in London a week from now. But you get him out there, you let him take his lumps, work through it, get out the other side, and see what kind of player you have before he gets to year two. Last thing I want to ask you, because we've already kept you way too long. I knew this was going to happen. You and I were going to nerd out. We're going to talk X's and O's with Drake May, and I was going to ruin your afternoon. But the last thing I have to ask you is, listen, your prediction for Drake May. If you want to give us a score prediction, that's okay too. But what do you think? What kind of stat line should we be looking at? How many bumps, quote unquote, in the road will he face on Sunday afternoon? What are you expecting?
I'm hoping he's going to have less than 25 dropbacks. Like, that's my ideal game, where you truly keep the foot on the gas for the run game. But I'll say realistically something like, I'll go 17 for 22, because I really do think that he's a smart passer. And I think that we're going to be able to see that against all his zone defense. I'll say 215. What's the averages? I'm so bad with math. Oh, 220 yards. I think 2 touchdowns and a pick.
I think people would be thrilled by that. Yeah. Don't you?
I would be.
They'd be cracking 200 yards through the air for the first time this season, right? Mm-hmm. 2 touchdowns, which would equal the number of touchdown passes they already have through 5 games this season. 2-1 touchdown interception ratio. Nice little completion percentage there. Taylor, I think the people would be all kinds of excited. Even more excited than they already are if they see that.
I hope I'm right, y'all. I hope I'm right. But either way, we're going to have fun. It's going to be a good game.
No doubt. Taylor Kyles, thanks so much for being with us, man. Follow him if you aren't already. What are you doing if you're not already following this guy, by the way? At TKyles39 on X. All kinds of great stuff there for CLNS Media. Thanks so much, Taylor. Really appreciate it, buddy.
Appreciate you, buddy. Thank you.
All right, great stuff there from Taylor. We're going to find out. Right, however this thing is about to look, we are going to find out. But it is my understanding they've been working on the Drake May set of plays for a while now. You know, he's been taking first team reps, he's been getting these scout team reps, but whether it's training camp, in season, the receivers should have pretty good chemistry with their rookie quarterback, and the offensive play caller should have a pretty good understanding of what makes his young quarterback comfortable. Now, I think it's also worth noting here, when it comes to what we're talking about, plays that he'll be comfortable with and the scheme around which Alex Van Pelt will be trying to devise a game plan to beat the Houston Texans, late in the week, so perhaps as you're listening to this very podcast, Drake May and Alex Van Pelt will have a conversation, and they will then go over types of plays Drake May likes in certain types of situations. Red zone, third down, blitz situations. Here's what I feel most comfortable with. As Brian Hoyer put it earlier this week on the game plan, you have to be your own best advocate. So speak up. Let the coach know what you like and what you don't so that you put yourself in the best position possible on game day. All right, thanks so much for listening, everybody. We're going to be watching this game very closely, as I'm sure you are as well. We'll be right back here with another Next Pats, where my guess is we'll be reacting to what we saw from Drake May. It's an exciting time. Hopefully you enjoy it. We'll talk to you very soon.